So when you guys started 2008, right?
2008. Fall 2008.
What was the? Was it because was it propagated because Polaroid was just going out of business and you guys were like, oh my god.
It's more. I mean, it's always more complicated. You know, like the simple story is that a man bought Polaroid in 2003 or 2004. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure the exact year. And he decided, kind of arbitrarily, that film sales were going down and that they were going to continue to go down and might as well just get out of the film business. So he started the process. He started dismantling everything. He told the guys in the negative factory, for example, make me enough negative to last the next 10 years based on current trends, and put it in cold storage and shut the factory down. So they did that. They looked at their trends, and this was, like I said, 2003, 2004, which I think most people would agree was, in the film business, would tell you is like kind of the bottom of the market. It had been going down for years, but 2004 was kind of when it hit bottom, and then it, in 2005, 6, 7, started to actually grow back a little bit. And so what happened was, they made this negative, they thought it was going to last them to 2013. It actually started running out in 2007. And was completely gone by 2008. And without the negative, there is no film. You know, it's the same with any kind of analog film. You have to have a negative. And that factory was already destroyed. And plus the guy, whose name was Tom Petters, was indicted for a Ponzi scheme and is now in prison.
Whoa.
Yeah. He pretty much single-handedly dismantled the filmmaking business for Polaroid.
How did the group, how did the project come about initially from, was it in Vienna?
In Vienna. Doc had been running a company called Unsalable. Mm-hmm. And Unsalable was, at the time, pretty much the world's largest seller of Polaroid stuff, single seller. Mm-hmm. And he sold mostly to Europe, I think some to Asia, some to the States, but he had, you know, he was really kind of a European company. And he knew people at Polaroid. He had, you know, been to the factories a few times and had talked them into making some new films. So he was aware of what was going on, I think, before a lot of people, and so he had a little bit of a jump. But he really, I mean, it kind of all came together at the closing party for the factory. It was there that he met Andre Bozeman, who's right now our COO. Andre had been running this factory for 25 years for Polaroid, and had, over the previous months, had to basically fire everybody and shut the factory down. So this was the closing party. It was literally like, you know, everyone was gonna go play golf and be retired. And they got to talking and they had a couple beers, and Andre told him it was impossible to make new film, and Doc was like, what if it isn't? You know, like, what if there was some other way to do it? Have you thought about other ways to do it? And he's like, well, we've got some ideas, but, you know, we worked for Polaroid and we made Polaroid film. We weren't paid to experiment. And he's like, well, okay, well, what if I paid you to experiment? You think you could make something new? And Andre, you know, gave it some thought. He was like, I think if we had some time and, you know, these 15 of the original guys and the machines where they sit, and maybe a year, then we could probably figure it out. And so Doc went back to his investors and told them that story, and remarkably they gave him the money to, you know, hire these guys and rent the building and pay Polaroid for the machinery and get started. Yeah.
Oh, amazing.
It's one of those things too that, like, I seriously wonder, I'm an American through and through, and I wonder if anything like that would have ever happened in this country. If someone had gone to a group of American investors and said, hey, we want to make a Polaroid film, but we can't. So we need some money to figure out if we can. And I think American investors would have been like, are you sure you don't want to make a website? Like, websites, that's where it's at, you know. Polaroid Polaroid can't make film. Yeah, we got the last factory. All the other factories are gone. Uh-huh. We managed to save one of the last ones.
Where is that?
It's in Enschede, Holland.
Oh, in Holland. That's right.
Netherlands. Uh-huh. Yeah. So that factory was where all the integral film was made. That's the stuff that spits out of the camera and processes in front of your eyes. There was another factory in Mexico that made the peel apart stuff that you pull out of the camera and then peel off to print. That's gone. The 4x5, 8x10, 20x24 were all made in the Boston area. We've managed to save some of that equipment, but not all of it. We're working with the 20x24 studio, who's bought some of the equipment to make new chemicals. We managed to save the 8x10 equipment as well, which was hidden away in a warehouse. I think basically it was set up in a factory somewhere. They decommissioned it. They tore it apart. They stuck it in this warehouse thinking they would get rid of it soon, and then kind of forgot about it. Polaroid made all their own parts in a, you know, in a self-contained way. And once the factories that made those parts were gone, rebuilding them was out of the question. So we had to find new suppliers. We had to basically talk people into making things for us that mimicked Polaroid so we could still fit it in this camera. You know, that was the whole goal. It's like we had a pack of film, like a Polaroid pack. We're like, we just need it to look like this. So the plastic case, the spring that's inside, the battery, and then all the components in the film itself. We had to find new people to make all that stuff. And then the guys in the factory had to figure out a way to make the chemistry work with what negative we were able to get. To give you an example, you know, this white mask, mm-hmm. which is what they call it, it's got a texture, it's manufactured to certain, you know, tolerances, so we had to find somebody to make that for us. The clear sheet over the film, we found a company in Germany that's a startup actually that makes that for us. It's important too because it has chemicals on it that help the when you spread the chemistry through the rollers, it migrates the stuff that you see to this top layer from the negative layer. Also inside here, there's about six other different parts that inside the frame that you don't see, but that are really important to making sure the chemical spreads properly, or making sure that, you know, the pH is right inside this thing so that it can process. And we just take all these things and assemble them into packs of film. You know, the assembly line tests the batteries and then puts them in the pack. It makes the little test the little spring, the little metal spring that's in every pack. So once we found people that can make all that stuff for us, which took us a good 6 or 8 months when we first started, it then was like, okay, so we've got all these suppliers. Can we actually make film out of that? Can we put all these things together and make something that works? And it took them another 8 months to figure that out, really, 6 to 8 months. So March of 2010 was when we put out our new film, but the guys had been working on it since November of 2008. Kind of like an accident, actually, that we managed to get that stuff. We were looking for Edwin Land's office chair, and we found the 8x10 machines, you know.